Welcome to worship at Community Presbyterian Church. Today's prayer was written by Bernie Schwenk. Lord, keep us aware that we are always in your heart, no matter the circumstances. Help us to know our need to be connected to you as you hold each of us in your loving care until we can again hold each other.
Sing to Jesus, His the scepter, His the throne. Alleluia, His the triumph, His the victory alone. Hark the songs of peaceful Zion, thunder like a mighty flood. Jesus, out of every nation, has redeemed us by his blood. Alleluia, not as orphans are we left in sorrow now. Alleluia, he is near us, faith believes, nor questions how. Though the cloud from sight received him, when the 40 days were o'er, shall our hearts forget his promise? I am with you evermore.
Bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and do not forget all his benefits, who forgives all your iniquity, who heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from the pit, who crowns you with steadfast love and mercy, who satisfies you with good as long as you live, so that your youth is renewed like the eagles.
The New Testament reading for this service comes from the book of 1 Peter, the second chapter, verses 9 through verse 10. The Bible says, "But you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people belonging to God, that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his wonderful light. Once you were not a people, but now you are the people of God. Once you have not received mercy, but now you have received mercy." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
When I met Craig Barnes, he was the pastor of the National Presbyterian Church of Washington, D.C. Now, he's the president of Princeton Theological Seminary. But then, with Craig, with Lloyd Ogilvie, and a couple of others, we formed a team to lead a preaching conference for pastors. And so we had the privilege, for me a kind of a scary privilege, of preaching to preachers. I just sort of imagined them staring at me, thinking, "So show us what you got, preacher boy." But I did my best, and God blessed our time together. Craig told a story that has stuck with me. And he talked about a time when he was a young boy and his parents adopted a 12-year-old boy. So he was added to the family. He came to them because the family's heart went out to him and because his parents were lost by drug use and overuse, for they lost their lives in overdose. What Craig remembered was how he slowly fit into the family. And he remembered how his parents spoke to him. Roger was his name. And they would say, as Craig overheard, "No, Roger, you can't behave like that in this family. No, Roger, you can't use that kind of language in this family. No, Roger, you can't fight like that in this family." And so Roger began to slowly assimilate into the lifestyle of what that family was like. He realized that to be a part of that family, to belong to that family, meant taking on a new lifestyle, a new way of living and talking and being. Well, the other interesting truth from that story is that Roger didn't have to behave properly to earn his way into the family. There was no earning to get in. It was just the grace and love of these parents who reached out to him and brought him in. And though he didn't have to behave a particular way to get into the family, it was obvious that he needed to behave a certain kind of way to really function within the family. Kind of the same way with God, isn't it? We don't have to earn our way into God's family. Jesus Christ earned our way into God's family. And then through Christ, he reached out to us and pulled us in. And so even though we didn't have to behave particularly to get in, he calls us to behave in a particular way while in the family. There's a story told by a Frenchman who was a part of a world war as a young man. And as he described his experience, for him it was just horrifying. The bombs and the bullets immobilized him, really. He hunkered down in his foxhole, and there below all of the smoke and the sound, he hid as best he could. And then a figure appeared on the edge of his foxhole and saw him down there. And he remembers him saying simply, "Son, grab my hand. Let's go do something grand for France." And he pulled me out of that hole into that grandness that was really my calling. It's kind of what God does for us. So no matter where we're hiding and what we're fearing, how we're immobilized, through Jesus Christ, God reaches to us and says, "Daughter, son, come, grab my hand. Let's do something grand for God." And we become a part of his choice for us. That's why he calls us a chosen people. Belonging to God means that we are a chosen people. He reaches out and touches us in such a way that we become different, that we become his. And we take on a unique calling. He pulls us out of the masses to be a part of his ministry, a part of his work, a part of his family. We don't earn that. God just gracefully gives us that. There's another war story that comes to mind. This one comes out of the world of film. You may remember and may have seen some years back a film called Saving Private Ryan. And it had to do with the fact that the top brass of the military came to Captain Miller and said, "Choose some men, you have to go and get Private Ryan out of the war zone. We can't lose him." And the reason he said we can't lose him is that three of James Ryan's brothers had already been lost to that same war. And he didn't want the last boy to be killed, meaning the guy in the middle of that top brass who was making these decisions. So Miller gets a patrol together and they go after him. They lose a couple of people in the process of finding Private Ryan. And in fact, once they found him and brought him to safety, Miller himself had been wounded, mortally wounded. So he was dying. But before he died, he looked at Private Ryan and grabbed him by the shoulders and said two poignant words: "Earn this. Earn this." And then he died. Many years later, when James Ryan was into his older age, he visited the grave of Captain Miller. And as he looked at the marker, he was heard to say, "Did I live a good life? Was my life worthy of being saved? Did I earn the right to live?" Tears were streaming down his face as he sought to be a proper answer to the challenge that Captain Miller gave him. Did I earn this? Our relationship with God is different. We don't earn our relationship with God. It's been won for us. We are the people of God by God's choice. We are his chosen people responding to his tugging of our hearts to be his. What did the Bible say? Peter writes, "Once you were not a people. Now you are God's people." Remember, as God's people, we're chosen by his holy and challenging touch. Well, the scripture goes on to say that not only are we a chosen people, but we're a royal priesthood. I'm fascinated by the fact that those two words are put together, that our identity is that of royalty and also of priestliness. A royal people. Royal seems to say that we are a part of God's reign. We are reigning with Christ. And as a part of royalty, we ought to be people who are being served, being honored, being recognized for the high position we have in God's kingdom. But then God puts, through his word, the word priesthood next to it. And all of a sudden the picture changes. We're not people to be served. We're not people to just boss people around to do the things that we want them to do. Being priests, in a sense, we are put down onto ground level so there we might lift other people up. So there, rather than being served, we serve other people. We have the power to ask for service, but we choose to use that power to serve others. That's what being the royal priesthood means. When we belong to God, we belong to a royal family, yes, but it's a family that stoops down to touch people in need, stoops down to help people who are helpless, stoops down because that's what Jesus did. The Bible tells us that he didn't come to be served, but to serve, sacrificially serve. So this ministry, this priesthood, is not just meant for the clergy. It's meant for all of us. When we say yes to Jesus Christ and to following him, we are saying yes to ministry. All of us in ministry, all of us active, all of us who are part of the family are to care for the other parts of the family, the other members of the family. No one is just to sit and watch. In our small or big ways, in our abilities, whatever they are, we are to reach out to others in support and prayer and help and whatever the calling is and whatever is needed. On Thursday, the National Football League is holding their draft. Sounds like an odd thing to do in the middle of this wide quarantine of activity. And yet they're having a virtual draft. Each team of the National Football League is choosing players to be on their team for their next season, hoping it all comes to be at the right time. Well, in reality, football and a lot of other activities are properly pushed into the back of life's bus because of our need to care more deeply for people's health and lives. But nevertheless, it's happening. But thinking about football gives me an interesting illustration for what I'm trying to say. When you think of a football game and you see this happening in a stadium, I think if you look carefully, what you will see is 22 people on the field desperately needing rest, and 40,000 people in the stands desperately needing exercise. Sometimes that's the way the church looks. There are some, a few, who are active in the care for church families, for the Christian family. And then there are a lot of people who are sitting and watching. God has not called us to watch a religious event. God has called us to be a religious event. No one's supposed to just sit in Christianity, watch a couple of priests, ministers. We are all called to be priests and ministers, according to this particular passage. We are to exercise our calling. We're to be on the field of life. We have been called out of our foxholes so that we can be a part of God's grand plan. There's a story told about a man named Jeff. He was a director of an organization called Love in Action, a service organization, helping people in a variety of ways. And after one of the days of work, which happened to be about 12, 13 hours long, Jeff was ready to go home and collapse. He felt a bit like he deserved it after giving all that energy during that day. But before he was able to really relax at home, he gets a call. He actually knew the young man, but he just almost didn't answer the phone because he didn't want to be involved in some request. Well, it was a request. Jimmy, this young man that he knew, had AIDS, and he was in a bad way. And he was calling Jeff and saying, "Jeff, please come. I'm frightened. I'm feeling horrible. I just need you to come and see me." So with some reluctance, Jeff got into his car, drove over to where Jimmy was, got to his apartment, and saw that he was in a bad way. And he had thrown up all over the bed and all over the floor. So Jeff just simply began to clean up. He got on his knees and got some rags and some water and began to clean up Jimmy's mess. While he was doing that, a friend of Jimmy's came into the apartment. His name was Russ. And after watching Jeff in his cleanup, he then said, "Now I know who Jesus is. Now I know who Jesus is. Jesus is like Jeff." Well, if truth be known, Jeff was a lot like Jesus. But he was a reflection of Jesus. He was acting like Jesus. Jeff could have been doing anything else. He chose to help Jimmy. Jesus could have done anything else and demanded the world to worship him and honor him and keep him on his throne. He chose to help the world. He showed us what it was like to be a royal priesthood. So that's what Peter's teaching in the Word of God is calling us to. Inviting us to belong to God, to get our identity from our belonging to God, from our relationship with Him. To be no longer a people who are nobodies, but a people who belong to the highest of somebody. A chosen people. A royal priesthood. That's our call. What more important time is it than today, than with all that we're facing in this world, than to be the people God called us to be for the benefit of others who needed a touch of God's people? Holy Father, I pray that we would be more like you want us to be, that we would be truer to our calling, that in some small or big ways, whatever our ability, that we care for others through our prayers, through our conversations by phone or email or text, through deliveries of supplies, perhaps, if needed, and we are able, through whatever actions can be helpful to care. Yes, Father, you've made us royalty, standing with Christ, but you've called us to be servants, the priesthood of believers. We lean on your strength to fulfill all of that. In your holy name, amen.
Of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty.
And now, may God, who the Bible says, can do exceedingly abundantly above all that we can ask or think, may that God bless you and keep you, watch over you, and take care of you. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.